Welcome aboard, everybody. Give me just a couple more minutes. I need to run to the restroom. I've got everything set up. Sorry, Captain Gombo. He wanted the, what's that? The classic disco version of the Learjet. But I tell you what, Captain Gombo, let me try at the back end of the stream and see if we can maybe practice with the belly landing and the gear destruction mode, and maybe we'll whip out the old disco version for that. Sorry, I guess I would have done that one instead. I picked my favorite out of the pack, but if I have to reload another aircraft, I'd have to restart the entire stream, because then I'd be screwing up the memory. So sorry about that, but we'll see what we can do towards the back end. So just gonna run to the restroom, enjoy the elevator music for a couple more minutes, and we'll get started. Okay, welcome aboard, everyone, to ADX Live HD. Yesterday was a nightmare. And another thank you again to everyone who stuck around. Oops, my mic was upside down. To you guys who helped me out over the last hour in trying to get the stream worked out. Oh, man. I mean, everything was fine on the ground. And then once we took off, the crap absolutely hit the fan. So my sincere apologies there. So hopefully we'll be able to do it right, because a lot of people joined the stream late and I got emails and Facebook messages, please could you do the Learjet again? Apparently there's a lot of interest in this aircraft, and a lot of people, I guess, seem to be on the fence. And I think part of the reasoning behind that is the fact that there are a few quality business jets with good, what's the term I'm looking for, with good systems modeling. Obviously Coronado has been delivering some business jets in recent times, and the biggest complaint there is really just lack of in-depth systems modeling. Of course, we have EagleSoft. A lot of EagleSoft's aircrafts are a little bit out of date, a lot of older things there, but for the most part, their accuracies in terms of systems is it's pretty good. It's fairly good. So, but we haven't seen anything from these guys in quite some time. It's been quite a while since we've had anything new from EagleSoft. So, up latest is the Learjet from Lionheart, and some of the initial concerns about it was that it would lack in systems depth. Now, one of the things you have to keep in mind is this is the old first generation Learjet from the, I believe, the late 60s, which of course was modified from the Swiss Concept bomber jet. And you can actually tell from the wings, if you look at the wings, I mean, the wings look like that of a jet fighter. So that's exactly what this is. And so as such, back then, there really wasn't much in terms of systems modeling back then. You know, it's all steam gauges. And so essentially what Bill did is he sort of combined more or less all of those early models into one model here, because obviously with the Learjet there are so many different variations that to try to pick and choose one of them would be difficult, I think, from an aircraft, or rather from a flight simulation aircraft perspective. So I believe what he did was he just sort of took all the best things about all of them and sort of fused them here into the 24 Bravo, which is what we have sitting in front of us today. So we're going to go ahead and dive in. Now, one of the questions I already saw is, can you make those people disappear? So before we actually get started with the aircraft itself, which I have in a cold and dark state. Let me just fix up Trek IR here really quickly. There is no, unfortunately, there is no cold and dark function for this aircraft. So when you load it up with engines running, you just have to go through the system shutdown procedure and then proceed to just shut everything down. And that'll more or less get us into our cold and dark cockpit, which is where we are now. But one of the questions was, with the features, is can you make Mr. I call them Mr. and Mrs. Affluent, because this is the rich couple in our jet here. And yes, you can. By clicking any of the seats on the aircraft, you can actually make them disappear by any of the click spots in the seat. So I guess for purposes of the flight, we'll make them disappear unless anyone wants them present. We'll just have an empty cabin today. And then just getting back to the feature. So as part of the cold and dark feature that I have now is the parking mode. And the parking mode does come complete with wheel chocks, engine covers, and pitot covers, along with the remove before flight pitot flags. Along with that also comes excuse me, just had my coffee. Also comes this very interesting wind shield or window covers. Now, the thing that I do and don't like about this is that as far as I could see from the manual, you cannot independently cover the window. So it's either, it's sort of an all or nothing thing, and either you're in parking mode or you're not. So I was not able to independently cover the cabin windows separately, as say you would with a Coronado jet. Additionally, this interesting forward windshield cover is very interesting, and I wonder where this comes from. Is if it's like a car windshield cover that you would keep like in your back seat when you want to keep the sun out, or what? Because that'd have to be a really big cover to cover that huge windscreen. So that's pretty big. But anyway, so we'll go ahead and dive back into the virtual cockpit. And to remove the parking mode, actually you can remove the yoke, which we'll do during the setup, and that'll make life a little bit interesting, or a little bit clearer rather. Right over here to the left we have the park mode, and if we just switch that off, now we have a full view of the windscreen from the virtual cockpit as well as our cabin. This is prepared V2.3, so now as you can see, unlike before, you have some of the sunlight filtering through the windows and onto our seats. Next up would be a couple of things I want to run through, but first let's go ahead and turn on the aircraft batteries. So now we have a little bit of power. Now we'll have to get the generators running fairly soon so that we don't run out of battery power. As you can see here, we do have independent lighting for the aircraft. So we have floodlights. I tried to do it early enough in the morning so we could see the difference with the cabin light by not starting midday. And as you can see, the lighting does run on separate circuits, so we're able to activate the forward flight deck lighting separately from the rear cabin, which is here. And now you see we have our cabin lighting activated. And then the next part, which is I felt kind of confusing, is the instrument panel. It's kind of weird. When I turn on the instrument panel, it seems to get darker, the panel as a whole. And I guess it gets darker so that the lighting of the gauges stand out. And that's what I'll do now. So isn't that interesting? It is sort of interesting. So the entire panel itself darkens, and then you can kind of see the lighting from the gauges. So I don't know. It's like a light turns off, I guess, in order for that to turn on. But you do see the difference if I go ahead and turn off the floodlight, which gets much darker. So I found that the light, the night lighting for the gauges wasn't really bright enough. I didn't notice anywhere in the manual where I could kind of brighten the gauges independently. So I do apologize in advance if I missed that in the manual. So, but other than that, let's go ahead and turn on the flat lighting again. Cabin lighting. Oh, that was already on. And I'll just turn off the panel lighting so that we can actually see it a little bit better. Okay, so as you notice across the annunciator, we have a number of error messages here. Generators obviously are off. We have an open door. And the inverters are off as well. And these are things that will get corrected once we're ready to do our engine start, which I suppose we can get underway with now. So let's go ahead and revert back to the external view. Let's close our cabin door, which is very nice. I like that the way the cabin door opens up. Nice animation there. And our pilots are now present. This guy's eyes, though, really, really freak me out. I pointed this out yesterday. The girl's looking quite cute, but this guy here, he just sort of has like this pinky and the brain thing. Same thing we do every night, Pinky. Try and take over the world. So, anyway, besides that, very good looking pilot couple here. And just getting back to the external views of the aircraft, one of the things that Bill was quite staunch about with his aircraft is that it really is meant to be used in prepared V2, which is what we're using it in. It does come as a triple installer, so it will work in FSX, it will work in prepared V1, but one of the things that he really notes is the fact that it does come with these high definition 4098 textures. It does not come with 2042, sorry, just thinking off the top of my head. It really is, they all come with these high definition textures. So if you have lower end PC specs, it does stay quite clear in the manual that you may run into some performance issues. So, and it does work, it's really optimized for prepared V2. It's a prepared V2 native model, so it just runs better in prepared V2. And as prepared V2 becomes more and more popular among developers are really now starting to make their products really native for prepared V2. And then they're actually just starting to go back and make the installers for prepared V1 and FSX. A number of developers have disclosed to me directly, both publicly and personally, that they really see prepared V2 as sort of the future and that they really are moving forward in that direction. But the good thing for FSX users is that because the backwards compatibility is so close, that FSX users won't be alienated, but nevertheless, you will start to see more things really just being developed primarily for prepared instead of being backwards compatible toward prepared, as we've seen in the past. I'm also on a Bill Womack flying spree. Yesterday I was at Seelitz Bay, which is where we had a lot of our issues. Today we're at Cushman Meadows, which is a fictional airfield out in northwestern northwest of Seattle. So this is another one of my favorite Pacific Northwest airfields, and probably not that conducive for a jet per se. This is really probably for smaller VFR flights, but the runway is far more than long enough to get off the ground. And the bad side about it is that the taxiways are really narrow. But nevertheless, I sort of just do what I want, and I thought it would be a fun airport for this aircraft. So with that said, we'll come back over into the virtual cockpit mode. Take a quick look at some of the comments before we proceed forward. Let's take a quick look. Once again, everyone, welcome aboard. Glad you're here. One of the things I also noted yesterday, and I'll touch back on that really quickly, is the Bendix weather scan here, and the fact that it does not have a weather radar implementation. Bill did actually update on his Facebook page that at the moment he doesn't have any details in terms of how to implement some of the existing technology to put in here, such as the Active Sky. So it is something that is in his mind as a future implementation, but right now he just doesn't really have the resources to get that going. But nevertheless, I did notice a comment there about perhaps maybe getting a GPS plugged in there. I do know that he did implement the default GPS. Let me just check the instrument panel to make sure. Yeah, the default GPS does exist. I don't know if you guys can see that on your screen, but you can use that as a secondary GPS. Let's close the window. I can tell you what I use, and let me get a second to just fire that up. What I use is the remote flight application, and let me go back to the open broadcaster to window mode for you really quickly. Windows here. So I actually use the remote flight server, and that's what this is. It's remote flight, and if you go on the Air Daily X daily news page, you'll notice there's a couple of ads promoting remote flight. And that's actually what I use to get this working. And I definitely recommend you check it out because they have a lot of applications, autopilots, everything, gauges, the whole nine yards, remote flight has. And this is actually what I use. Let's go ahead and start the server. And actually, let me plug in my camera here for you really quickly, if I can find it, so that you can see how it shows up on my iPhone. So for those of you who by default just needs a GPS, one of the things that I find that just works really great for me is that I don't really have to worry about having a GPS on screen, because I can use the GPS either on my iPhone or my iPad. And I'm going to pull up the GPS on my iPhone really quickly for you. I have both the iPhone and iPad here, but on the iPad I'm actually using the what's that thing called, the instruction manual. So let me see if I can turn on my camera for you just really quickly. Let's go back to the active simulation, minimize to tray, video capture device. Let's see if that's working. I might need to move that up, order, move to top. Ah! Okay, there we go. It's a little big though. Let's see here. If I can just point that at my iPhone. Sorry, you probably won't be able to see that too clearly. That's probably a little too bright. Yeah, I fear that's too bright. Let me see if I can lower that brightness a little bit. Maybe you can see it a little bit better now, maybe. So this is what I use. Hopefully that's not too too dark, so that you can actually see that. And then I can actually import. Come on, tap the screen here. Come on, you. Ah, sometimes it's there's like a click spot. Here we go. Flight plan. I can actually bring in all my flight plans from Flight Simulator, and I can do this outside of Simulator. This also comes with an autopilot app as well, but I won't need that. So right now we're going Cushman Meadows to Stewart. I already have that here in my flight plan mode, so I can just click that. Activate flight plan here, and now you can see the flight plan line going up to Stewart. So I actually use this on my iPhone outside of flight simulation. That way, you know, forget having to implement, you know, a GPS or anything like that. I can just use this program. The app that comes on iPad actually has a high definition map. The one on the iPhone is a little bit more simple, but yet it works really, really well. And then it gives me additional details such as my altitude. Base altitude right now is 762 feet. It gives me my heading, gives me my speed, glide slope information. So it gives me all of that. It tells me what my next waypoint is, distance to next waypoint, all that stuff. And then, of course, it gives me my route estimate. So time estimate to the next waypoint, or time estimate to destination, stuff like that. So I highly recommend remote flight. So I definitely recommend you look into that, and you can find that via the daily news page on airdailyx.net. I just don't have the URL off the top of my head. So that's the map that I will be using as far as that goes. Okay, so we can turn that off. Okay, so As far as the GPS goes, that's how I am keeping track of where I am. And let me brighten that back up again so I can see that. Okay, so hopefully I don't think our battery has run out yet, so that's a very good thing. Okay, so let's go ahead and go with the engine start. Now, for me, the first thing I do whenever I get into an aircraft is turn on my navigation lights. So that just lets everyone around the aircraft know someone's in here, something's going on, and that just kind of lets everyone around the aircraft be aware of that. The next thing I want to do is turn on... Actually, yeah, we want to turn on our jet pumps. And the jet pumps is the processes of starting and stopping the engine. So when you do your engine shutdown, you'll just simply shut off your jet pumps, and we'll do that once we're on the other end. The next thing we want to do is go ahead, our batteries are on. So the next thing we want to do is just go ahead and start with the engine start. And so we'll grab, and I really like the animation here, which is basically a pull and drag setup instead of a click setup. So let's go ahead and pull and drag, and we should be able to start the number one. And I guess you kind of have to hold it down for a minute there and kind of wait for her. Wait for the tachometer here to... There she goes. And so now we have the number one running. Now what we want to do is, right now we're actually not supplying power to the battery. So what we want to do then is just grab that same starter and move it up into the generator position. And now you see here the amps have moved up. So that's how we get our power. So you want to make sure you do that right away. So click it upward to the generator. And then now we will start with the right engine. Again, I really wish there was a cold and dark state for the aircraft, because it saves time in terms of having to go through the trouble of clicking everything off and shutting everything down. All right, and back up into generator position. The next thing you want to do is bring your inverters online, and the inverters, the autopilot runs on the power from the inverters. So that's your next step you want to do, especially if you plan to use the autopilot, which primarily runs on the inverters. And as we pull up, now you see the volts are coming up, and there we go. So that's basically the startup function for the aircraft. Very simple. Next thing we want to do is, I probably wouldn't do this until we're airborne, but we'll go ahead and do it now. Want to turn on our cabin air and our pressurization we want on as well. You really don't need pressure below 8,000 MSL, but who the heck is going to operate a Learjet under 8,000, right? So that's important. the cabin pressures and temperature gauges here are actually inoperative, so you're not going to see these animate as you either try to control the base altitude that you want to have for your pressurization inside the cabin. None of that's going to come on, so it's just there for kicks and giggles, but... no animations there. Second thing we want to do is move back over to the right side and start turning on our heat. We want our windshield heat, stabilizer wing heat, and pitot heat. And if you don't do that, you could actually crack the windshield, from what I understand. So that's very importante. And this is the click spot here for your yokes. Just FYI. To bring them back. The next thing we have here, we'll move up to the annunciator. Now you've noticed that all of our error messages that we had previously are now off. The only error messages we have now are the armed, what do they call it? Fire bottles. So we want to turn these off, arm them rather, in case we have an engine fire. The next thing you can do to just run a test on the annunciator is we have two switches here underneath the glare shield. You can click those. Oops. Ah! You can click those. Ah, come on. Oh, it comes on and off quickly. You can click it and just test it to make sure that all of the annunciator warnings are on. And mind you, any of the annunciators that show up in yellow are not errors. That just simply tells you that these particular components of the aircraft are off, and it's just notifying you that you may want to check those just to make sure. Now, there's a couple of other things I want to bring to your attention that I think is really cool, and one of the things that makes Lionheart Creations so cool. And if you forget anything about today's stream, what you want to remember is this one particular aspect. And let me just check your comments really quickly, because one of the things that I missed yesterday is the stream went bad and people were notifying me, and then I didn't check over to see, and then luckily Greg gave me Greg gave me a text and said, hey, people can't see you, so that was good. So I just want to make sure I can see what's going on. Oh, actually, Greg says, I'm sure the Learjet supplies custom-built windscreen covers that are included with the accessory items. Okay, so that's pretty cool. I wonder where it's stored, though. I wonder where that's stored. Okay, so here's one thing that I thought was really, really awesome. If you forget anything about the startup procedures or anything of that nature, and you just really need a good guide to know where to find things, or just to familiarize yourself with this cockpit, check this out. Boom! That is like one of the coolest freaking things I think I've ever seen in my life. Now, naturally, this should not detract you from reading the manual. It shouldn't. But nevertheless, if you're lazy like me, and let's face it, when you're a man doesn't read the manual. A man just goes in and starts putting together IKEA furniture. So, nevertheless, this will still help you out. So you have everything you need to know in terms of where everything is. I think this is the coolest freaking thing ever. So this just sort of serves as an FYI. Fuel cutoff also cuts off your engines. You have your fuel levels here, parking brake. And we will do a dump wingtip tanks procedure when we're about approximately 30 minutes out from landing. We will go through that motion and just watch the animation, because you have to actually clear the wingtips. Basically, how the Learjet works is, it starts clearing the fuel from the wings first. So what you want to do, what you want to do when you need to, when necessary, is you can supply the fuel from the tanks into the wings when necessary. Or did I get that backward? I might have gotten that backward. So anyway, that's one of the things you want to keep an eye on with refueling your tank, so on and so forth. And how you can keep an eye on that, actually, let me pause this again. And you can go to the instrument panel and pull up the fuel map. And here you can actually purge the tip tanks manually by simply clicking this area here. And you can clear them out that way. But how we're going to do it is the physical way, from the virtual cockpit, by way of actually doing a fuel dump procedure. So let me go ahead and clear that. Where is it? Wrong menu. Instrument panel, fuel map. Actually, while we're in here, let's just pull up some of the other things here. We've got a clipboard. Actually, what was the purpose of the clipboard? I didn't see. Bring that back up again. Can I put anything on here? Flight systems notes. Oh, here we go. Oh, no, wait. I can't click on anything. I see different. Oh, here we go. Sorry. Okay. Oh. Where are the click spots? Oh, I see. The click spots are left and right. All right, so general characteristics on the clipboard. Aircraft dimensions and specifications. Here we have our checklist. Wow, I can just like totally turn off the iPad. This is cool. And we have our checklist. This is so cool. Flight and systems notes. Oops, what happened? Oh, there's a light. It actually lights up. Is that what that is? Oh, what happened? Oh, it won't go back through anymore. I don't know what happened. Views, instrument panel. Where'd it go? Clipboard. Okay, I don't know. I clicked something and now I can't get it back. So anyway, I'll leave that to you to play with on your own, within your own devices. Let's take a quick look at what else is in the instrument panel. Autopilot panel, fuel panel, electrical systems, radios and engines, audio panel. I think that's it. Turbine failure placard, landing warning placard. Actually, let me remove the fuel map. Do not land with fuel in your wing tanks. All right. And there was another placard here. Hang on, let me bring up the other placard. Instrument panel. What was the other placard? Cold and dark placard. Do not use another aircraft's cold and dark. Oh yeah, okay, so we actually saw this stuff. We can get rid of that. Okay, another cool thing I want to point your position to is the fire button here. And if you click that, you get this really cool sort of alarm. But check this out. Fire! Alright, now that is cool. Now I wonder if I blow the bottle. Well, I guess, yeah, it's just arm, but that won't actually blow the bottle. So we can just put that out. And the fire is gone. So that's another cool little fun toy that I'm sure you guys won't mind playing with. I didn't have my parking brake on. My aircraft moved forward. Okay, so other than that, what have I missed? I think I pretty much covered all the bases. I didn't turn on my beacon light before starting the engine, so that's a slap on the wrist. That's me slapping my wrist. Did I forget anything else? Landing lights. I think that's it. I think I didn't forget anything else. So let's take a quick look at any more comments, and then we're going to go ahead and taxi out. Yun says, looking at my frames, he's getting jealous. That's Jetline Systems. I can't promote that enough. Jetline Systems. Computer systems designed specifically for the sole purpose of flight simulation, although they'll do everything else. In fact, I installed my first video game on here, which was every now and then, I believe it or not, I get bored of flight simulation, or if I'm working on a review, I need to just completely separate myself from the flight simulator. So every now and then I like to play a video game. So I like Counter-Strike, but Counter-Strike is on my laptop. But I bought, what's that race car game? Grid, the new Grid race car game. I like race car games, so I like to drive those race car games when I need just to get away from the simulator to help me think. So I installed that on here for the first time, and that thing, man, that just runs so smooth. It's really awesome. So anyway, anyone up for a grill party? DeAndre's hosting it. You know what's funny is my wife said that I should host some kind of event, like, you know, like flight simulation event or something like that. But I have no idea where I would host it and how that whole thing would work. So, and if anyone would even show up. But anyway, hell yeah, a barbecue or something would be fun. All right, so I think we're ready to go. Let me just double check. Yeah, I think we're good to go. I think I covered all my bases. The annunciator panel is completely dark, so that means I don't have any faults or errors before getting started. Flaps 1 is the takeoff configuration. And, okay, so let's turn on the taxi lights. Again, really cool animation. You pull up 1 for taxi lights, and note, I turn on the left taxi lights. They are independent. So if you come down here, you'll notice. Oh, wait, how come I don't see the taxi light? Let's go back here. I don't see a taxi light. Let's turn on the right. Oh, did I do something wrong? Or is it just too late in the day to see them? Let's turn on the landing lights. Let me just make sure I can even see these lights turn on. I don't know why I didn't see it turn on. Oh, maybe I missed a step. Do the strobe lights turn on? Let's see. Yeah, the strobe lights turn on. Why not? Hmm.
up one position, navigation light. Oh, that's navigation lights. I'm tripping. No, that stays on. Landing light. Yeah. I wonder, what did I do wrong here? Okay, maybe I missed a step here. I don't know why I don't have my taxi lights on. They did work yesterday. But anyway, in a perfect world, you would be able to control the lights separately on each gear. But I don't know. Maybe it's too bright outside to see them. I'm not really sure what happened there. So really sorry about that. But anyway, let's go ahead and get started. Oh, I gotta turn off my strobe lights. We're not ready for that yet. All right, so anyway, like I said, this airport's not really all that conducive for an aircraft of this size. But anyway, I really like Cushman Meadows, so I thought this would be something different as far as a starting place. So we'll be doing some grass taxiing here. The taxiway is a little too small for the Learjet, so I'm just going to go out onto the runway and then backtrack. And if I must say so, the modeling is really accurate and it looks really good. In fact, my stepson came down yesterday and he goes, "Oh my gosh, what's that airplane?" He's really getting into World War II aircraft. And so we bought him this book that basically has all the aircraft from World War II. So he's coming down and he's talking to me about the Avro Lancaster and the Stuka. He's like really, really into these aircraft. So I've been getting them installed in the simulator for him to kind of check out. And we've been watching a lot of World War II videos, Dam Busters and all that stuff. So he's really into World War II aircraft. He's not that much into modern aircraft, but when he saw the Learjet, he goes, "Oh, wow, that's a modern-looking airplane." And I'm like, "Modern? This thing is not only before your time, it's before my time. This is like one of the first early-generation business jets ever created." And he's like, "Really? It looks brand new." I'm like, "Well, it looks brand new, but it's actually really, really old." So he really thought it was a cool-looking aircraft. And but once I showed him the virtual cockpit, then that's when he saw how old it is. Because he was like, "Oh, wow, that's like the cockpits of my World War II airplanes." And I'm like, "Yeah, these are all just steam gauges. There's no big fancy screens and computers and stuff like that." So this sort of appealed to him because he sort of likes the classic look and feel of airplanes and not so much the modern look. So anyway, thought that was pretty interesting. So yeah, this is it looks spot on. So the modeling, very, very well done. And it's quickly working its way up to the top as my favorite business jet so far. You know, it doesn't have sort of the same feel as a Coronado plane, but with that said, I'm glad that it doesn't, because I don't want everything to look like Coronado. You know, I want to feel like I'm flying something different, and I want it to look different. And I appreciate the fact that Lionheart Creations has their own sort of technology and visuals, so I actually do appreciate that. So a lot of people initially were kind of comparing it to Coronado, and it's like, do we really want everything to look like Coronado? I don't think so. You know, I think Eaglesoft sort of has their own take on things, and Lionheart has their own take, and I think that's sort of a good thing. I think it's a really great thing, actually. And what I like that Lionheart does that Coronado doesn't do is the different cabin layouts. And like Captain Gombo was bringing to my attention earlier, he wanted to see the 1970s retrofit interior of the aircraft, which comes with more of a shag-looking carpeting and comes with that 70s hippie wallpapering and everything else, or disco, I think he called it. So we'll try to bring that up a little bit later on. But for now, let's go ahead and get her off the ground. And let's bring back my yokes and just do a quick self-check of everything. I'm not really looking at the checklist now because I have a pretty good memory. I remember pretty much mostly everything that I read from the manual. So just double check. Da-da-da-da-da. The good thing with this aircraft, there's not too much to double check. So it's pretty easy just to kind of do a quick once over the panel and then get going. Yep, flaps at one. Yep, okay, I think we're good to go. All right, now this aircraft is like a bat out of hell. And I mean that literally because it moves very quickly. Floodlight off. Actually, I don't think that instrument panel darkens anymore because of the time of day. So we'll just go ahead and turn everything off. I think it's bright enough for us to see anyway. All right, here we go. Wait, let me just double check. Any last comments before takeoff? Ah, okay. All right, here we go, guys. Let's get going. And I'll try to take, or Greg, if you can, send me a text message again, just in case if after I take off, the stream takes a dive again so that I can fix it as quickly as possible, rather than continuing to fly and then not noticing until well after the fact. But hopefully those issues have been fixed. And let's release the brakes and go for it. Oh, this thing's like a rocket. And if you notice with the sounds there, when the landing gear was down, you could actually hear the wind hitting the landing gear. Flaps up. And so then once you raise the gear, then you no longer hear that wind. Now, from the flight deck, it's actually really, really quiet. It's very quiet, and I don't know that I like that. I actually like to hear engines. Let's bring the power back a little bit here. Now you can hear you can kind of hear the wind a little bit. That's just sort of my own little personal thing. I like to hear engines from the flight deck, but from the inside, it's surprisingly quiet. And mind you, this aircraft is overpowered. You could fly this bad boy. Not only can you fly it on one engine, but you could bring it into overspeed on one engine. So speed management is key. So notice I forgot my strobe lights again. Like an idiot. Oh, crap. I'm such a failure. Hang on. Strobes on. All right, and let me just make sure we're still streaming. Yeah, that's the other. Hopefully the stream is still working okay. This is about when everything took a dive yesterday, so hopefully everything is still running. When Abby mentioned the takeoff was pretty cool, new underwear, that's the other reason why I like that runway, because you see those trees coming up quick. So... although I got a little bit more ground speed than I needed, because I really like the effect of just really moving fast on the ground. None of us get the opportunity to drive things like the Bugatti Veyron, so this is about as good as it gets in terms of a fast acceleration. Just taking a look at the external view, and I'll try to pan slowly so that your screen doesn't pixelate, but the quality of the external is very well done. And if you ask me, I think it looks just as good as a Carnotto. The only thing is, Carnotto has some really good effects, like the weird sort of how you get that sun glare on the scratches of the wind, you know, the windscreen and all that. You know, they have a lot of other little cool effects and stuff. But yeah, it's not that big a deal to me, to be honest. All right, we can give it a little bit more power, and let's bring it up to 20 degrees above. And start to turn to intercept our flight plan here. And as I increase speed, you'll notice once again that you can't really hear much of that noise anymore. That's kind of interesting how that is. And you can see the wings from the flight deck view as well. Let me just double check the landing lights again. I can't really tell if they're on or not. I don't think they are. I don't know what I did wrong with the landing lights. One of the things I pointed out, though, with the animation is right under the engines. One of the things I tried to point out, yes, out of the bottom of a cowling like that. I don't think that's right. So I think that maybe should come out of the back of the engine instead of underneath it. I don't know. So in this particular case, I think that's something that might need to get fixed. Okay, and we're already passing through 15,000 feet. So was anyone counting how long it took us to get there by any chance? Very fast. Okay, so let's go ahead and take a look at the autopilot operation. Actually, you know, now this is one of the things I don't like about the autopilot. And that is that when I am scrolling, I just don't know what I'm scrolling to. I have to really rely in order to see where I'm at. But nevertheless, we're going to give it a shot. As a matter of fact, I hadn't set my altitude yet. We're already passing flight level 185, so let's go ahead and I'm going to try to fly with my left hand here on the stick while I try to set an initial step altitude. Let's say flight level 250 for now, just so we have a reference. Okay, now we'll hit the autopilot master switch. Once you get that green light, that means your autopilot is working and is on. And again, you will need your inverter switches on in order for that to work. And altitude, and let's see, the climb rate now is dropping to zero, correct? Let's wait for it to go to zero. Okay, one, two, let's see what the default is. Okay, so it looks like it defaults at roughly 1,500 feet per minute. That looks like 1,500 feet per minute. Going, it looks like it's going to 2,000 feet per minute, maybe. Just want to get an idea of where it's going to default to. So that looks like maybe 1,800 feet per minute. Now this aircraft should be able to climb up to something like 6,000 feet per minute, if I'm not mistaken. So I'm going to try to increase it a little bit more. Let's see, right now we're at Mach decimals 0.62 Mach. So let's see if we can increase our rate of climb a little bit. You see, now you notice where it says vertical speed setting. I just wish it would actually tell me what my vertical speed selection was, so I don't have to rely on the VSI so much, but that's okay. Ooh, I see it's dropping. What's going on? Are we encountering some weather up here? What happened? Oh, duh. We already reached 245. I'm sorry. We're already at 250. All right, let's go ahead before we get into overspeed and increase. Yeah, we already made to overspeed. So actually, I'll leave it at overspeed for a second so you can hear the overspeed alarm. You heard it for a second there, but then it went away. Let me increase power so you can hear it. There you go. And here on the annunciator, we have the overspeed. All right, so let's bring the power back down and let's increase our rate of climb. And the speed is dropping. That alarm should extinguish in a second. There it goes. Excellent. Rate of climb now is roughly 3,800 feet per minute. Oh wait, let me see if this will tell me. 3,802 feet per minute, okay. So we can actually climb faster than that. So let's continue to increase our rate of climb. Oops. Oh, I'm clicking on the seat here. Let's continue our climb up to, I just don't know what I'm setting. That's the only thing. So I have to wait for the VSI to get to that point before I know. And I'll get to your comments in just a moment. I don't want to ignore anyone. going to increase power a little bit. Right now we're passing 4,200 feet per minute. Let's continue to watch the climb. We're already at 30,000 feet. God, this thing is fast. We're going to continue our climb to fight level 4. We're actually going to go to cruise altitude is going to be 450 will be our cruise, our flight level. Let's see. One of the things I want to avoid, though, is maxing out the engine. So I'm keeping it just above, but just below full power, so that we don't flame out. Oh, one of the things I didn't note before is the realism setting, which is here. Activate realism. I'm a little bit skeptical to activate the realism now because I haven't played with it yet. And that's what we'll do next after we land, is I want to play with the activate realism function. And the reason why is because I don't know what the actual setting is that the engines will flame out, and I don't want to flame out the aircraft en route and then have to start all over, because I need to know what the actual benchmark is. Now, according to the manual, if you just go flat out full power for more than 15 minutes, then they will automatically flame out. But my thing is I don't know what full power is. In other words, I might not have it at full power, but I'm afraid that even if I'm just a centimeter back, that they might still flame out. So until I know what the physical benchmark is for that, I just don't want to play with that yet. But we can still play with that with the disco colors afterward. Passing flight level 365 for flight level 400, actually. And 0.75 Mach currently. So now that we're at higher altitude, let's go ahead and drop our vertical speed here a little bit. Again, I don't know when I'm dropping it to. I have to wait for the VSI to catch up in order to tell me exactly what my selection is. Da-da-da-da-da. 3,000... dropping down to 2,000. Starting to slow down a little bit. Let's drop it down a couple of more notches here. In fact, I don't even know if the original Learjet even came with a vertical speed selector. Oh. See, I just don't know. I have to really wait for this thing to bounce around. I have no clue. It looks like it's defaulting here. So let's go ahead and try to climb it up a little bit more. Where are we at now? 60. Okay, so let's just bring it a few notches up. This should take us to like 1,100 feet per minute, I think. Or are we at 40,000? We're at 40,000. Okay, let's just continue climb up to flight level 450. And let's see what our vertical speed is here. 14, 15. Oh, I think it's going to default at 18 again. It should. I think it'll default at 18. I think I feel pretty safe. We're at 0.82 Mach, so we've got plenty of airspeed to continue climb. Okay, so yeah, I think the only thing here really with the as far as missing feature really is the weather radar. I mean, that's something I would really like to see, but I'm going to take that even a step further. Take a look at the external view here. We're way up there, man. All right, so just taking a look at my iPhone, we have roughly 55 minutes, a distance of 461 nautical miles, 59 minutes en route. Those numbers will drop once we reach cruise altitude. one of the things, besides having the working weather radar, and this is just like Cushman Meadows, and the reason why I decided to take off from Cushman Meadows is because of the fact that it is a fictional airport. So, in leading in from that, for those of you who are big fans of Cushman Meadows as something that doesn't exist, you sort of appeal to my better interests. And what I'm alluding to is one of the things that I would actually like to see in this old Learjet is actually a modern avionics outfit. You'll notice a lot of people, for example, with older, like, for example, Beechcraft B-200s, you'll see a lot of people have gone in and they've retrofitted their entire flight deck as for modern. You know, some people have put in Garmin G-1000s and all kinds of crazy stuff. I actually wouldn't mind seeing this older aircraft have a completely new just glass cockpit across the line. I think that would be really awesome. Because one of the things that my stepson said, and he had a really good point, is the fact that it looks like a modern aircraft. I mean, it really does. It doesn't look like, you know, a 40, 50-year-old airplane. It still looks sleek. It looks new. Obviously, the tip tanks are an old look for it. But if anything, it looks like a fighter jet that has bombs on the side of it that it could drop at any moment. You know what I mean? So I feel like the one thing that would make this thing just super brand new, like, you know, Batman's jet, is to have that full sort of modern outfit with, you know, G-1000s and, you know, all that. Or similar to, like, the flight deck of an Embraer Phenom, you know, like what is that thing called? It's escaping me at the moment, but just a complete modern avionics outfit would really just make this thing just absolutely 100% spectacular. And I assume it would be, fictional for it, because I don't know if anyone has retrofitted their Learjets for a modern avionics outfit, but I feel like if that is fictional, that's the one fictional thing that would just make this thing super cool. And even sort of thinking back to Coronado's PC-12 coming up, they have a PC-12 NG model that Pilatus makes that looks just like, I kid you not, it looks just like the flight deck of a G5. And the flight deck that Coronado chose to go with is sort of that older flight deck, but they do have one that's like a G5. And just imagine sticking a G5 type of flight deck in this bad boy. I mean, that would just be the icing on the cake. It really, really would be. So, anyway, we've leveled off at cruise altitude at flight level 450. We're above all the other traffic. Let's take a look at our airspeed. Airspeed is at 0.86 Mach. I believe max speed on here is 0.87 Mach, if I'm not mistaken, depending on conditions. So our time en route right now is roughly 53 minutes. Not really sure what else I could say to keep you guys entertained unless I sped up the simulator. But before I do that, since we're now at cruise speed, I can now go back and just look at some of the comments you guys have got and see what's going. Look at those frame rates. In fact, let's just pull up both so we can take a look at everything. Wind 252, magnitude at 25 knots. We might have a little bit of a crosswind on final. We'll see how that goes. All right, let's take a look at some of your comments and bear with me while I try to scroll up and see what's going. Hopefully the stream is working smooth for you guys this time around. I hope so. Really sorry about yesterday, but I really wanted to make it up to you. Okay. Let's take a look. So, yeah, going back to 99 Sebring, as far as replacing the radar with the GPS, that is a good question. I imagine, though, that Bill would have probably come up with something like that. But again, I still recommend the remote flight app that that I mentioned earlier. But nevertheless, you guys might want to approach Bill about maybe implementing the GPS somewhere on
on the panel, or at least replace that dummy weather radar that's in there and put another screen there. I agree. KL says, concerning putting a great weather radar that fits the panel that is the exact era, not modern, I would be putting that or making it retrofit. I sought to put a weather radar in this girl. I wanted it that bad and could not arrange it. I could not even get code so that to make it to make the screen retrofit. And I think that's what Bill said. That's what Bill said. So, when Abby says the two couple that sits in the back of the flight deck look like a couple of selfish rich bastards. Ouch! You know what's funny? Let me just go back to the virtual cockpit real quick. What's funny is they don't look too happy in their marriage, do they? I mean, look at this. Hang on. They might be on their way to sign their divorce papers or something. You know what? He probably didn't make her sign a prenup. They're not looking at each other. You know what I mean? Like, maybe they're on their way. I don't know. They don't look like they're in a very happy relationship, these two. So Bill didn't animate them. So, you know, I don't know, but they look like they're ignoring each other. So maybe they got into an argument like just before the flight. And as a fact, I'll come back here into the cabin, and we'll take a look around. Some nice interior modeling here. And again, each model comes with its own cabin. So you get a different variation of carpet. This funky wood trim that you get different variations of the coloration of the wood trim. The seats, you get different cloth fabrics for the seats. And of course, the wallpaper. This one has more of a modern wallpaper, and that's why I like this one. And I actually like the external paint. This one is my favorite. It's just, it has a modern cabin, but not a very modern flight deck. So with that said, this one is my favorite, but each one comes with its own. So yeah, these two don't look like they're really speaking to each other. And we'll move along to the far back and look out some of the windows. In fact, let me get closer to the wing here. We're gonna go right past Miss Affluent here. And look at the wing textures outside the aircraft. As I move, you can see some environmental textures and reflections here. So, I mean, those are the 4098, is it? If I got that right, the 4098 textures. So it looks really nice. I did notice a fault with this piece of bubble gum that someone said here. There's some random like purple square. And I'll just come outside here to take a look. It's like some kind of random purple square that's like outside of the virtual cockpit. Well, I don't see it now, but I saw it yesterday. In fact, I probably should make and save some of these cockpit views, huh? Or these external views. Let's see what the cockpit looks like from the exterior. Obviously, the reflection's not entirely accurate, but that's okay. But anyway, yeah, there was like some piece of like bubble gum, some kind of like purple square. Obviously, it's not a big deal because it ain't like you guys going to be flying the aircraft from the back seat. But anyway, I just like to notice little faults and stuff like that. And that was one of the things I noticed, was that little square thing. So the quality of the interior is very nice. Okay, guys, you can go. Thank you. And let me get back to some of the comments here. Sorry about that. I kind of get off on me tangents. Yun actually asked me if I could show the engine fan blades. He said he loves the shadows. I guess we did look at them. I guess it's easier to see the fan blades when the aircraft is not in motion. So, Yun, if you want to remind me to do that again,
After landing, then I can show you the fan blades again. But just en route here, I can kind of try to pan back here so you can take a closer look at the animation. So we can take a look at the fan blades again once we've landed. But that's it for you. All right, let's come back inside. Let's see what other comments we have here. And also, just note this really cool how the sun is shining inside through the windows and leaving these shadow effects. I'm telling you, Prepared is a very, very stable platform, you guys. I'm not being funny. It is very stable. You notice my frame rates. I do not have any hacks. Besides, like, for example, the high mem fix, I am using the full screen VSync fix, but besides that, I don't really have any other hacks or anything going on here. So it's a stable platform, just out of the box, out of the virtual box, if you will. Okay, let me go back and look at some more of your comments while we're in flight. Greg says, I'm sure the Learjet supplies custom. Oh, yeah, we went over that. You guys are laughing at something I said, but I don't remember what it was. 99C Brink said, I know that I had all the Orbix airports working in 2.2, but once I updated to 2.3, all the objects at the airports disappeared, even the P3D V2 compact airports. 99C Brink, actually, many of the Orbix airports do work in V2. Some notable ones that aren't working for me is that I noticed so far is Diamond Point Airstrip. What's the other one? Jackson Heights or whatever? I can't think of... shoot. I'm trying to remember what the other one... It's the other airport that's right across the sound from Diamond Point. So there's a couple of others that didn't work. But, like, for example, Cushman Meadows, that doesn't have a triple installer. And as you saw, it works just fine. And then where we're flying into en route to right now, which is Stewart, which is 45 minutes out. That one actually worked really well also. I didn't have any issues there. So, so a lot of them work, but some of them don't. And this is 2.3, so I haven't that I know of, but I haven't visited all my airports yet since I installed 2.3. So, boy, this computer in this screen is really making me hot. I'm going to have to go grab another fan. Give me one second. Okay, let's see, still scrolling my way down here. Let's move back to the flight deck so we can keep an eye on our situation here. So again, very nice interior modeling. Look at the way that sun just spills across that flight deck. That's a beautiful view, isn't it? This is the ultimate office. There is no office in the world that gets you a view that's just this good. Even if you do work in the Burj Dubai. All right. Let's see. Just scrolling down. A lot of comments on my commentary. When Abhi was talking in reference to when I said, you know, real men don't need manuals, and when Abhi goes, that's what I always thought. I don't need no damn manual to tell me how to fly a plane. Okay. Oh, Aviation was asking, does the fuel drain out from the plane and onto the tarmac? I don't know. I guess we could try that and see. We will be performing a fuel dump before we land. So at least we can get a look at what the animation looks like. But that's a good question. I guess we can just try it for kicks and giggles. Zulu Kilo says, that's why a man doesn't need a manual. Yun says, rest in peace, headphone users. I guess I yelled my boom a little too loud. All right. Aviation says, Jetline systems are the best. I couldn't agree more. You know, it's funny. A friend of mine, Jerome, in Germany, we were having a phone conversation yesterday. And he tuned in for some of the live stream. And so he asked me, so DeAndre, how is that? He calls me a lucky bastard because he really is jealous of the computer, but he said, so how is that Jetline computer working out? I mean, how is it really? How is it? And I told him that it is something of a polygamous marriage in my house in reference between the differences between the Jetline computer and my wife. So he thought that was pretty hilarious because I really, really am sort of married to this computer unlike any other computer that I've ever had before. So I couldn't really come up with a way to explain how close I am with this computer in terms of just how much it's changed my life in terms of flight simming. And so that seemed like the most fitting thing, is just to say I'm more or less in a polygamous marriage now. I have two wives. Yeah, that was pretty funny. Anyway, scrolling down, let's see. Oh, Aviation Sim asks, what's my Steam name? I also play Counter-Strike constantly, have 506 hours ranked in Gold Nova. Right now in Counter-Strike, or in Steam, all I really play is Counter-Strike anymore, which is Source, and I actually haven't played that probably since the beginning of this year. But I used to be a member of a clan called Noob Salad, which I don't think exists anymore, and if they do, they don't support Counter-Strike. But at one point, Noob Salad was like the most popular clan of Counter-Strike. I remember at one point, we had like 6,000 members, and I was a mod on there for a number of years. And we had what was great about Noob Salad is we had a lot of girls that were part of our community. I think we had something like 30 girls at one point, or females at one point, that would come on, and they were freaking good. I used to get my ass handed to me by these girls. I have them all on Facebook, and I keep in touch randomly, but for the most part, everyone just sort of died out of Counter-Strike, and so as they died, it just sort of went away. So every now and then, I log on, and I still see some of my clan friends and stuff, but my Steam name is Pneumanix, and it has the Noob Salad clan logo in front of it, and I just kept it there for old time's sake, because every now and then I still see a few people that are, ex-Noob Salad clan members and stuff. But yeah, I haven't signed on to Steam in ages. I don't think since this year I've actually played, but anyway, still scrolling down. Let's see. When Abhi says, if I have a pool, he'll come over and swim. Yeah, if I had my own pool, I wouldn't have to go out to another pool and swim every day. Let's see. Air Swimming X. 99 Sebring says, just take the heat sink out of this 477K and use it for a grill. Fry some eggs on that bad boy. let's see. Still scrolling down. Oh, Yun says, yeah, good old times, you could fry an egg on your GPU. Well, this bad boy has liquid cooling, and it actually stays pretty cool. But between this and the Dell 30-inch, just both together, they generate a lot of freaking heat over here. I mean, when the winter comes around, it's great because I could sit here, and I'd probably never have to turn on my heater. But during the summer, like now, and it's still summer in Southern California, it'll be summer here until November. So
Just with the heat already, it doesn't help. So I've got two fans blowing on me at the moment because I don't want to burn out my air conditioner and have a high bill. My air conditioning bill last month was $400 freaking. So yeah, we scaled back on that, on that a little bit. Anyway, let's see. What else we got? I'm a bit slow getting to your comments, but since we're in mid-flight, there's really nothing else to do. We're still 37 minutes en route to the next waypoint. And also, I elected for a scenic arrival, so we're actually going to fly the aircraft down and into the sound on that approach into Stewart. So it should be a fairly scenic approach. We'll switch to the external view for a little bit so you guys can watch the outside a little bit. Actually, you know what's funny? I don't think I turned off my landing lights, even though you can't see them from the outside. But anyway, let me just turn them on one more time and see. I don't know what I did wrong. The landing lights are not coming on, nor did the taxi lights. I don't know what I did wrong. So I'm sure it's probably my fault, and I just have to figure out what it is. Fan switch. So anyway, just turning them off now. I don't know. I have to figure out what I did wrong there. All right. More comments about the cool takeoff. And that's the other thing too. I like those really narrow runways because it feels faster when you got those lights and everything just kind of breezing by you really quickly. So that's also cool. Yun says, I once had a GTX 590 running at 105 degrees 24/7 because I had it in a case which only supported Max ATX motherboards. But I was using an EATX motherboard. Me and my father just modded the case to fit the GPU and CPU, but got a bit too hot. Now my 590 died and got it replaced by 780. 99 Sebring says, you can hear the engines from the cockpit of a Citation, CJ. Wanabi says, I think we're all excited to see the belly landing and stuff later. Great stream. Keep up the good work. Hey, it's my pleasure. And Wanabi says, I think the isolation absorbs a very specific frequency of sound. So when the engine gets higher in decibels, I think the isolation of the frame will absorb those frequency waves of sound compared to the lower frequency sound when the engines are at idle, etc. That's a very interesting point. P3Ron says, could I take a couple of screenies of OBS settings and post them on Facebook? Yes, I will get that for you, P3Ron. Buyandre is here. Is it Buyandre or Buyandre? And he asked about the weather radar, which unfortunately doesn't work. Yeah, that's what everybody's bummering about, is the weather radar. Now that it's possible in FSX, one of the things that was thought previously impossible, now everybody's like, we want it, we want it. So when you see that dummy thing on the panel, you know, everyone's just kind of like, yeah, we really need this. So I totally understand. Hang on a second. Cancel. No. On. Off. I had the aircraft on heading, but now the aircraft has gone off heading. Let me see what's going on here. Why did we go off heading? Let's see what happened. Sorry, I don't mean to make you guys... Wow, my nav just turned off. Why the hell did that happen? Okay, I don't know what happened there. I just happened to look at my iPhone and realize we were off heading. Something I did turned off the navigation switch, so... We're going to have to go back and intercept it. We didn't intercept it by very far, by a couple miles. At present, we're about 34 minutes from the next waypoint, so it should actually be a lot less than that once we're back on track. I don't know what happened there, but I'm glad I looked down at my iPhone. Okay.
And I think DeAndre is correct about the model looking very new and future, kinda. Well, the guy who designed this plane, his son John Lear, said that his father was inspired by the many deeply black projects at the A4 area and Area 51. He had many contacts in those types of things, and that's how he was inspired then designed the Learjet by his last name. Boyandre says the stream keeps buffering. Am I to assume it's just me since no one else is complaining? Can somebody please, someone else give me any feedback on the stream if there's a problem so that I can fix it? Because yeah, I don't want you guys to have any issues like yesterday. I really want to try to get as clean a stream as possible. So if there's any issues, please let me know so that I can correct that as soon as possible. Yun says the stream is fine. Wanabi says stream is fine. So Captain Gumbo says sometimes it's buffering, but today it's fine. Okay, good. And then Wanabi says maybe he could fix the code so that we can use Reality XP rather radar, something like PMDG did with the J41, and it works like a charm for me. What else? Oh, the rivets, yeah. Boyandre's referring to the rivets on the exterior of the aircraft. And Boyandre says the purple square is just a couple of polygons that have not yet been textured. Probably skip the unwrap process in 3D Studio Max, yeah. But I'm just one of those kind of people that I always crawl under seats and crap like that just to see if there's errors. So, again, that's just how I am. I'm kind of a... Well, I used to work for Emirates Airline several years ago, and I was an operations auditor. I worked in their consumer affairs and service audit department. So it was literally my job to fly around and actually have that keen attention to detail. You know, you have to fly and audit flight attendants and all that kind of crap. And you really, really, really did have to have an attention for detail. So that's just one of my things. Even today, I'm an auditor, and that's one of the things that the airline pays me to do, is to find things that no one else is looking for that might become a big problem later on down the line. So when it comes to flight simulation, I just go digging under seats and seat pockets and crap because I'm just looking for something wrong, you know. So that's just me. So when it comes to my reviews and I nitpick at stuff because that's just who I am, I guess. Not so much a perfectionist, but I do look for those things. So anyway, only two that we found with this aircraft so far. Young, stop building your PC and just go buy a Jetline system. Okay. DeAndre, did I use the aircraft, the AC as APU or something? Damn, $400, man, geez. What? I don't get it, Wanabi. Did I use that AC as an APU or something? I don't get it. Oh, how do I spell pneumatics? Here, I'll put it for you now. Actually, here, I'll tell you exactly how to find it. Actually, no, I can't. I'll just type it in for you. And gotta text the wifey. Give me a minute here. The wife just got a huge promotion at her job recently, which means more money for us. Yay! Anyway,
Okay, so... Oh, it's just Andre. Okay, so the B-U-E is silent. All right, got it. When Abby says, yeah, we have to remember, even to this plane, even though this plane is very old, it's still very advanced and complex. According to John Lear, he still considers a Learjet an experimental plane because it's very complex to run and very unstable at low speeds. That's what I remember. As a matter of fact, if you guys watched my landing yesterday, and this is one of the things that I actually forgot about the Learjet, you'll notice that not only was my approach shit, well, crap, excuse my language, but with the Learjet, you actually have to be careful about the speed. I believe the approach speed with full flaps is between 100 and 120 knots, and you really have to be careful because of the way the wings are designed. At low speeds, they will lose lift, absolutely, and it will stall and funnel approach and crash. So you really, really have to be careful with your speed with this aircraft more so than any other aircraft because the way the wings are designed, I mean, if you look at them, they're taken from a jet aircraft, from a fighter aircraft. You know, these are not typical wings that would be used on a commercial jet of any sort. So at low speeds, it's very unstable. It's very unstable. So it's important to know your weight, and it's important to know your proper approach speed when you come in. And yesterday, I really screwed the pooch on that. And what happened was, what I did was, all I really needed to do was put my nose down. Because as you notice, the don't sink audio came on because I was sinking. And really, what I needed to do was put the nose down to sort of gain that airspeed. But instead, I wound up increasing speed. And then what I wound up doing was coming in too fast. So, I mean, obviously, I set it down smoothly and had plenty of runway to stop. But that wasn't a proper approach. And I'm going to try to avoid doing that again this time around as well. But, yeah, that speed management with this aircraft is very important. So the fact that I had that issue was actually a very good thing just in order for you to see what happens when you don't correctly manage your speed when you're coming in. Time to next waypoint, 26 minutes. And when Abhi says, it's not really the experimental phase, of course, but in his own way of thinking, he said something like that. So everyone's saying the stream is still running good. Okay, cool. Yun says, keep nitpicking. Seriously, that's great. There are no other people that do that. And they rather try to hide the errors. and when Abhi, actually, if you go back and look at my Dubai review that I wrote on airdailyx.net, I actually included a couple of pictures from the inside that I took of the Emirates headquarters where I used to work and all that stuff. So you can go check that out. Let's see. Oh, it's not silent, but my name is just Andre, just a nickname. Okay. And when Abhi says, correct me, Andre, it's exactly what John Lear said, something like you really have to be on the throttles or it will drop like a rock. Yes, and it will drop like a rock. So, and I think I've proceeded through all the comments, so that's good. I haven't put up any news yet on the news page because this was sort of my first priority, was to get this stream working. But so far a couple of people tipped me off that the Thai Creation, Thai Creation Bangkok Airport was released today for FSX. So that's the only news I have right at this very moment. Is my aircraft going off track again? No, I think it's fine. Distance 206 nautical miles, 24 minutes, and we will start the descent in about 15 minutes. Actually, in 10 minutes, we're going to start our descent. Does anyone else have any questions? Oh, there are some questions here. Andre says, can you show us the pop-up bubble texts in the cockpit? Pop-up bubble texts? What is that? What pop-up bubble text? I'm not sure what you mean by that, dude. So I'm in the flight deck now. If you want to tell me what pop-up bubble text you were referring to. Ooh, Yun has some information about prepared. Okay, I've got to get on that. Ooh, is the Technum
released? Oh my god, I'm gonna buy that right now. Holy crap. I'm gonna buy that right now. I'm gonna buy that. I'm gonna buy that. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I can stream that.
Yeah.
I swear, Yun, if you are screwing me around, I'm gonna come through your computer and I'm gonna punch you right in the nose. Just kidding. Wilco. I was really waiting for this one, and I'm telling you, the problem with Wilco is every time they come out with something... Oh, Wilco Pub. Yes, honey, I ate my breakfast. She's so sweet. Today's my off day, so she left early for work, and she left breakfast on the counter. Okay, Wilco. Is it released? Is it released? The thing with Wilco is every time I buy something from them, they let me down. They let me down. They let me down. They let me down. And then I buy the next thing, and then they let me down. So, but with this Technum P200, I want this plane so bad. What's that company? That company that Ant Airplanes turned me on to Technums, and ever since then, I've just been really on a rampage to get it. Okay, I'm on the product page, and there's no purchase button here. Let me go to Facebook. There's no purchase button there. Because I will stream that bad boy today if it's released. Let's see, Paxim has an update on Nagasaki. Alabeo released the Cardinal for X-Plane. Oh, wait. No, never mind. Oh, there's a note here from Bill Ortiz. I'll read that to you in a second. What else? Yun, I don't see anything. Do you have a link saying that the Technum is released? Because I ain't seeing it. Okay, let me see what Andre's talking about real quick. Bubble texts. Oh, yeah, I'll do that. I did that at the beginning of the stream, Andre. I'll do that again for you, yeah. Let me see, Yon. Is it really released? Where is the purchase button? There's no purchase button. I'm on the page. There is no purchase button. I see 16.49 euro, which is cheap. But there ain't no purchase button. It says email to a friend. Is it not released in the United States or something? Maybe on a Euro website? There's no purchase button. It says availability September 2014. There is no purchase button. Sorry, but I don't see a purchase button, so I don't think it's released. Okay, let me show you the bubble texts. And to activate the bubble text, it's right here. You see this little square button here, Andre? You click that, and that brings up the bubble texts. And pretty soon we're actually going to dump the wingtip tanks. I have to check to see if there is still fuel in them. So there are your bubble texts. And the other thing you missed as well, Andre, is the fire. If I do this in flight, will it screw up my plane? Should I take the risk and push it? Let's risk it. And so now we've got an engine on fire. And I think it only fires the left engine, right? Yeah, I think it's just the left engine, or the right, the number two, excuse me. So it doesn't actually affect the performance of the aircraft, it looks like. It doesn't look like it flamed out. It looks like it's still spinning, so it's just an animation. I think that's really cool, though. I love stuff like that. So there's our engine fire. I just wish there were a way to blow a bottle in there instead of just turning it off. But anyway, we'll turn it off, and then that's it. So that was the other feature that you missed earlier, Andre. I almost called you DeAndre. anything else? Oh, now we'll have an emergency. Keep calm and glider in, right? Okay, so let's see. Well, let me check our position, and I think we need to start the descent, and then I need to check our fuel. Hang on 1 second. Anyway, does anyone see a purchase button on Wilco's page to get that Technum? Because it ain't coming up for me. Because I kid you not, I'll buy it right now, and then we'll just go right into streaming that. I got plenty of time. Russ Wright is texting me. Russ, I'll get back to you in a bit. Where did it go? I've got 150 apps on my phone, so okay, here we go. All right, 17 minutes. Okay, so let's go ahead and take a look at our fuel. We'll bring up the fuel map now. There is a keyboard command to bring it up, but it won't work for me because I've cleared all my keyboard commands and programmed everything into FSUIPC, so that ain't gonna work for me. But fuel panel, oops, that's a fuel panel. Actually, you know what? No, let's close that. Instrument panel, fuel map. Actually, we've actually pretty much burned out the tanks, so we won't need to do a fuel dump. Let me just dump what's left while we can. Close window. Let's just try to dump what we can so we can see the animation. Transfer. Cross fuel flow switch. Right tip wing fuse. Okay. Let's just try to dump them and then see if we can see the animation. I'm gonna have to click quickly because we're almost out of fuel. Ah, come on, track IR, stop. All right, here we go. There we go. So now we're dumping the remainder of the fuel from the tip tanks, and we're just gonna purge them out. And then we'll start our descent. And actually, while we're doing that, let's take a look at the fuel map and watch in real time the fuel start to deplete. Instrument panel, fuel map. Actually, they're empty. So that's it. We have 0 pounds of fuel left. 853 pounds of fuel left in the center tank. And then 1,165 pounds in each wing tank. So that is it. We still have way more. We had way more than enough fuel for this flight. But you can purge the tanks manually by clicking on something on this window, because I did it before, but I just don't remember how. All right, so let's go ahead and stop dumping fuel that we don't have. Anyway, just so you can see the animation one more time, there's a fuel dump animation. Let's turn those off, and actually let's do one wing at a time, just take a quick look. In case your fuel weight is unbalanced, I guess. All right, so we'll turn these off, and let's go ahead and begin our descent. Did anybody find out how to purchase that plane yet? I don't think so. I think you were just looking at the purchase page there, Young. All right, let's bring back the speed. What's going on with Track IRs? Acting dummy. Is it not properly on my head? What's going on here? Hang on, let me fix my Track IR. Every time I look down, it's like acting funny. Okay, so let's bring the speed down. And you do need time to slow this bad boy down too. Yesterday I found myself, I did another flight yesterday, the same route, and I found that I actually had to use the spoilers because at a certain point, it just wanted to hang at like 100 knots. I mean, not 100 knots, at 150 knots. And I can't actually drop flap until I think I'm under 100. Not under 100, what am I thinking? It was hanging at 200, and I needed to get it down to 100, I think is what it was. Or I need to get it down to 150. Alright, so speed is starting to bleed off. And we're going to start to... Let's just do a continuous descent down to flight level 185. Now, once again, I have no real way of, well, actually, it looks like it's already started. The VSI is showing minus 1,600 feet per minute. I guess we'll just go by the default setting. I guess in the aircraft CFG, default vertical speed is set at somewhere around there. It's like 1,800 above and something like... 1600 below. In fact, we can expedite that a little bit more. Why is it doing the passengers loaded thing here now? My quick spot is off. Let's say 2,000 feet per minute on the descent should be fine. All right, let's see. Oh yeah, so yeah, it looks like it's a pre-order, guys. I'm not pre-ordering anything. Oh, is it the Falcon that's released, the 7X? Yeah, I don't think I'm going to buy that. Okay, we'll take a look at the 7X. Yeah, maybe that's what Young meant. Maybe he meant the 7X. Yeah, I'm kind of thinking like what 99 Sebring is saying. Not 100% sure about the Falcon. I'll wait to hear reviews and maybe some HD texture mods. Yeah, I don't think I'll be going after that one, to be honest. They just let me down too many times. And really, if you look at the previews between the Technum and the Falcon, obviously those are two different teams. And the Technum looks promising. My only concern about the Technum is I'm really wondering how many polygons are in that thing. To be honest, it looks like it might be a heavy load, but we'll find out. But that's the one that I'm really looking forward to. And Hawkeye says the Wilco website is absolutely the worst. Yeah. Yeah, and KL's confirming it's pre-order. Yeah, I'm not going to pre-order it. I'll wait till it's out. But yeah, I will do a stream on it when it's out. No, Jan is still maintaining that he meant the Technum, but yeah, I think it's just pre-order. Maybe the 7's on pre-order.
Okay, let me see what you, let me see what's going on, Young. Hang on. So, okay, I'm prepared. On the prepared website, it's saying, no, this is not saying it's released. It's just an announcement that they're developing it for prepared V2. And they have an exclusive gallery on the prepared V2 homepage, but our news page. But it's just an announcement. It's not a release announcement. It's just saying Wilco Publishing announces the P206T by Technum for prepared V2. It's an announcement. It's not it's not a release announcement though. Yeah, it looks like they got that wrong. But yeah, no, it's just an announcement. Boy, you got my hopes up. I'm like, we are gonna jump in that plane immediately. All right. We've got 14 minutes to the next waypoint, and like I said earlier, the plan is, I actually created a nice little flight plan that's going to take us straight through the sound. I don't know what sound it is or what it's called, but it'll take us straight through the sound. So we'll get a nice sort of scenic approach as we make our way through and into Stewart. We'll have to kind of navigate the valley there and stay between the mountains, but it should make for an interesting approach. As we're now passing flight level 340. So everything this plane does is pretty fast. It's got a rapid ascent. The thing rockets right off the doggone runway like you're on a freaking aircraft carrier. its climb rate is really fast. We actually didn't climb. It said in the manual that you can do a 6,000 foot per minute climb. We actually didn't even do 6,000. I think the highest we did was something like 4,500. But even then, that was still a rapid rate. I mean, we were at flight level 300, like what, within five to 7 minutes of after takeoff. So, I mean, that's still pretty fast. I don't know. I happened to look up and I'm like, oh my God, we're already passing 30,000 feet. And those external textures look very good. Let's zoom in on those external textures again. Lots of rivets. It's amazing. Rivets are still the things that hold our airplanes together even today. Even to this very day. Reminds me of the old Howard Hughes, what was that thing, the Hughes? I can't think of what that plane was, but I remember it was just not enough rivets. And that was back in the 50s, man. So they still hold our airplanes together. Let me just browse through. I know someone had another comment that I missed. No, Yun, you're just fine. We love you, buddy. Sebring saying, how did I get the Orbitz airports working? I'm using the FS Estonia. What do you call that thing? The FS Estonia... conversion tool, whatever you call it. And it's been worth it because I would say about 90% of all the aircraft, not aircraft, but products I have, it works using that tool. But I should also note though that for developers who are going in and creating P3D, native P3D models, personally I prefer to just go and get the native P3D models of the aircraft so that it shows up with all the that takes most advantage of the prepared V2 features. So for those things, that stuff I'm waiting on. But companies like Orbix who offer them free anyway as triple installers, it's no big deal to do that. But when they do come out with the triple installers, I do go after them
and replace them with the proper version so that they accurately take advantage of the prepared features. And they probably run faster too, so that's an important thing. All right, so our condensation is gone. We're now down to flight level 2. We're at 27,100 feet. Continuing our descent, we are 11 minutes to the next waypoint. And this thing is just smooth. It's smooth. This, you know, the proper home for this airplane really is prepared V2. And she is looking beautifully. Okay. Hawkeye says, how was the startup sequence? I missed that. I don't know if Twitch lets you highlight videos anymore, so I've got to quickly find a way to upload this to YouTube or something, or at least download it. But yeah, when we started off, we started off at cold and dark, and then we just went through the entire motions getting it up and running. So definitely once, actually, you don't, I don't even think you need to wait till the end of the stream. Sometimes Twitch just starts putting it up there, but you can definitely go back and sorry, I lost my train of thought. Go back and see that. KL says, well, the P3D webpage says now available for Wilcom Publishing. So it seems like release announcement. But where do you buy it from? Let me go back and look one more time at the Wilco homepage. Refresh. No, it's still saying availability September. Wilco Publishing announced a new title, Hi-Fi Simulation Scenery, the P2600-6T by Technum. If you have created liveries, interior, FSX and prepared, HSI, RMI, DME indicator. There's nothing here that shows that it's released. Let me go back to the homepage. TBM, latest news, TBM 850 CD available. Wilco Publishing versus Windows 8 compatibility table. There's nothing on their homepage that says it. Let me go to their Facebook page. August 11th. What's today? Today is September 3rd. Their last post about the Technum on their Facebook page was August 11th. There's nothing here on their Facebook page saying it's released. So I'm going to let that go. Oh. I wanted to take a look at the Falcon page, but someone said it's available for pre-order. I'm not really big on pre-ordering stuff, so. I mean, I just don't pre-order things that are going to be widely available on release. I mean, for me, it's like if I'm going to pre-order something, it's because people are going to be lined up out the store down the block to get it, and by the time you get it, it might be sold out sort of thing. But when it comes to digital downloads, I mean, it's not like a digital download is going to sell out unless it's designed to. All right, are we heading down to 185? So I have a little bit more descending to go. Mach 0.47. So Sebring, hopefully I explained your question. Sorry. Sebring says, I would do a better texture work, like Coronado. I'd buy the Falcon in a second. I still think this one is just fine. Like I said early in the stream, I don't want everything to look like Coronado. I like to be reminded that I'm flying something else from somebody else. But yeah, as far as the Orbic stuff, yeah, I mean, just download the latest libraries. Should be fine. All right, now down to 185. And we're actually looking at nautical miles now. So now we're down to 204 knots. I'm going to bring that speed back up to 250 knots. We are 8 minutes from our transition. Let's bring the speed up a little bit. get it back up to 250 knots because I don't want to have to try to slow this thing down too much when I'm ready to continue descent. And we will continue our descent in 7 minutes. You know, I managed to run my mouth for almost, 2 hours here. Hopefully you've been kept entertained enough to stick around, huh? Okay, Captain Gumbo's back. Let's see. Did you miss any emergencies? The only thing you missed was a fuel dump and an engine fire. I'll do the engine fire for you again. Let's do both. Let's do a fuel dump. Oops, I'm above 250. That's fine. We'll do the fuel dump one more time and a fire. We'll just do them all. Oops. Man, this... I think it's my eye point that keeps making them show back up. All right, let's do that. Let's see, we'll dump out of the left engine and then we'll have the fire, I think, which comes out of the right engine. So there's a fire and a fuel dump. So we're mixing fuel with the flames, which is very smart. Nice smoke effects too, smoke and fire effects. I mean, could you imagine that? You're dumping fuel and then there's a fire going on at the same time. The fire would just suck its way straight on the fuel vapor trail and then right into that engine and then boom. All right, let's turn that off. Okay. All right, 3 minutes. Actually, we can continue our descent now. I can see the sound coming up ahead. Let's back up our power. And we are going to descend down to 10,000. So we need to get well below 250 knots. When Abby says, yeah, DeAndre, it's all good, man. You have tons of energy. Hey, I love this stuff. Well, well, so everyone get your meat out. Barbecue on the engine. All right, we're going to go down to 10,000 now. And the default vertical speed is 1,600 feet per minute, as the VSI will show us. Well, actually, it's a little over that, isn't it? And actually, if I stick my head up over the glare shield, you can see this is the sound where we're going to pick it up. The sound runs from this direction, and then it turns and goes up this direction, so we're just going to intercept straight across and then follow the sound all the way down as it snakes through into Stewart. And there will be a crosswind, so if I can just remember to put my landing gear down. Actually, if I forget the landing gear, that's probably not a bad thing, because then we'll see what the belly landing animation looks like. So